It's amazing how time seems to fly by when you're having fun. Sometimes it's hard for me to believe it was 2 decades ago when I made my boxing debut on HBO. Back then, I was just a kid.
It's hard to see how fresh it can last.
In the beginning, I showed Joe Frazier and the boxing world that I could punch. That was one night against Muhammad Ali. I'd rather forget.
Muhammad Ali!
Then came the time in my life when I thought it was necessary to hang up the gloves and concentrate on something much more important than boxing. In retirement, George Foreman would become a new man. And then in 1987, I knew it was time for me to come back. I knew there was still much for me to accomplish. Through hard work, I earned a shot at the heavyweight championship. A great opportunity against Evander Holyfield. I showed that I could compete against younger fighters. Although one night against a rough and tough Alex Stewart in Las Vegas, he hit me a lot more than I would have liked. And at my age, you don't like fighting like this. And so tonight, HBO celebrates its 20th anniversary of covering boxing and its third decade of covering George Foreman. So sit back, relax, get ready, because tonight's fight is going to be a good one.
Then his decision loss to Evander Holyfield in April of 1991 was the last fight, April of last year against Alex Stewart, the fight which created the bloody and swollen mask we have shown you a few times tonight. Larry Merchant, let's get down to business. We know Pierre Kutzer. We saw him against Bo in July of last year. Does he have the capacity to embarrass George in the same way that Stewart did here last April?
Not in the same way, because Stewart, as the fight developed, became a boxer, and George doesn't like to fight boxers at this stage of his career. What we have here in Kutzer is a guy who comes straight at you like a choo-choo train, like a fastball. He's right there. Kutzer is a throwback, really, to the great old catchers in prize fighting, like George Chavallo and Tex Scobb, guys who try to break your spirit and your hands on their jaw. Tough, strong-minded guys, but guys without a big punch. And in addition to that, Kutzer is susceptible to cuts, so he would appear to be made to order for this George Foreman. But let's remember, both fighters are coming off bad beatings. One of them is 44 years old. We just saw a hellacious fight. Who knows, we might be in for another one.
So it's Kutzer, the catcher, against Foreman, the man with the wry sense of humor. And to continue the baseball analogy, our Gil Clancy actually trained George Foreman back in the dead ball era prior to his long retirement from the ring. He's 44 years old. He took a beating from Stewart. Does he still belong in there, Gil?
Well, I think he's picked the right opponent. George's best punch is a left jab, and Kutzer eats left jabs. The only thing, you can hit him with 3 jabs, 4 jabs. Kutzer will punch back. You have to remember George Foreman's 44 years of age. The skin doesn't have the elasticity anymore. He could get busted up in this fight, but I still think he's got enough to win it.
But he's an unknown quantity, really.
Absolutely. It's a toss-up going, and you just don't know what you're going to see.
All right. George Foreman, despite his age and all the questions, adamantly supports his own right to make decisions about his boxing future. He says he does so on behalf of all Americans over 40 years of age.
You know, in life there's a saying, never pass judgment on a man unless you've walked in his shoes. Well, it's kind of the same in boxing.
in this sport, you'll never begin to understand a fighter unless you've laced up the gloves and stepped into the ring. There's nothing like it. To me, the sounds of the gym are like music to my ears. The sparring, the speed bag, skipping rope, even the smell of sweat. And then there's the night of the fight, the crowd, the excitement. I can't even begin to describe it. Boxing's in my blood, has been and always will be. I'll be the one who decides when it's time for me to leave the ring. No one's going to tell me when I should quit.
To retire or not to retire? That's been the question in the boxing community ever since George Foreman lost to Evander Holyfield. Why in the world, we ask, does George Foreman continue to fight? Many in the game will tell you that George is a much better businessman than a legitimate heavyweight contender, and that he has now become boxing's greatest con man.
Let people say what they want to. George Foreman would never try and con the public. If I felt in my heart that I couldn't fight anymore, I'd walk away without any regrets. But I know that I can still fight and compete with any heavyweight today, so why not fight?
Even those who question Foreman's motives applaud his pugilistic journey. What began in 1987 as a comeback to raise money for his struggling youth center in Houston has turned into more than a fundraising mission. From his ring earnings, Foreman has collected enough money to finance the center hundreds of times over. The only thing Foreman hasn't acquired in his comeback is the championship belt. So many believe what was once a humanitarian cause has now become a festival of money and ego.
For me, it's not about dollars or cents or championship belts. For me, continuing my career is all about doing what I love to do. And sometimes it's hard. I'll admit there's times when I don't want to do it. And at my age, it's getting tougher. Running at dawn, the long hours in the gym, having to watch what you eat. But I've learned in life most things are tough and difficult before they get easy. And when you accomplish your goals, or you look into the mirror and you say, wow, I did it. How about that? Did it.
If nothing else, George Foreman has become the undisputed champion of the Big Cell. In boxing, no one is bigger, more admired, or more in demand.
4 out of 5 George Foremans prefer the taste of new Doritos tortilla chips with more natural cheese flavor.
Who taught you kids how to eat like this?
You, Dad.
It takes a big man to go up against George Foreman.
Oh, big guy. No. I'm so big, sometimes I even scare myself.
But you look good. You look great.
You only saying that because it's true.
Don't make me take you out of here, all right?
From talk shows to endorsements, now his own situation comedy, George has done exactly what a superstar is expected to do. He entertains out of the ring and in the ring in a big way.
I think people really like watching me because I could be your next door neighbor. I'm approachable, someone you can relate to. I'm the type of guy you'll see playing with the kids, walking the dog, or barbecuing in the backyard. So when I fight, people like to turn on the TV sets. It's almost as if they're saying, can this old guy really do it? So you see, I gotta show them.
For HBO, Foreman has been a gold mine. Regardless of who he fights, people watch. And because of the extraordinarily high ratings, HBO has been generous with its paychecks and sometimes too accommodating in the selection of George's opponents. Yet despite Foreman's appeal, there are many who believe the Foreman act has grown stale, is no longer funny. And after the Alex Stewart fight, some worry that by staying on longer, he risks his health.
I'm concerned a 45-year-old man can really get hurt. And I'm concerned for him because he's in a young man's sport. And the history of boxing, I think there are only 5 heavyweight champions whose last fight was a win. And I want to remember George Foreman as a winner, not a loser.
Debate it all you'd like, but the fact is George Foreman continues to fight. At 44, will George ever be able to make a 40-something fighter into the king of the heavyweights? Will patience be a virtue for boxing's elder statesman? Or will Father Time, or some unfortunate injury, put an end to George's traveling show? Time, even more of it, will tell.
Back live at ringside in the Reno Sparks Convention Center, and both fighters are already in the ring. There is George Foreman, still ranked among the top 5 heavyweight contenders by all 3 governing bodies. He is ranked number 1, as you see there, by the IBF. He gets ready for his 75th fight. The losses were to Muhammad Ali, Jimmy Young, and Evander Holyfield. Among his 71 wins are enough knockouts to give him the highest knockout percentage of any heavyweight champion in the history of the sport. And that current inactive streak of 279 days is the longest in the second phase of his career. And his opponent, Pierre Kutzer, you last saw him here on HBO and live last year when Riddick Bowe got a TKO in the seventh round that catapulted Bowe toward his heavyweight title shot against Holyfield. Since then, Kutzer was the victim of a similar TKO at the hands of Frank Bruno in London.
Legitimate question about whether he's taken too much punishment, why they put him back into a fight 2 months after he took so much punishment from Bowe.
Nail of the tape.
Even an anvil can break.
Pardon me?
I was just saying, Jim, that even an anvil can break.
And Kutzer is something of an anvil, yes. You see the tail of the tape, and you see that George weighed in at 258 pounds, same weight that he carried against Stewart, but he appears to be slightly tougher and more well-toned this time around. He has a 42-pound weight advantage. Punch stat numbers, Larry.
All right, here is our punch stat profile of how many punches these fellas throw. You see Foreman with a very high connect average, and he throws a lot of power punches. And there's the big jab that George likes to throw and throws very effectively. And as Gillis said, that could be the key punch of this fight.
Same rules as in a Tommy Morrison, Paul Williams fight. Three judges scoring the fight. The three knockdown rule is in effect. If a butt occurs and that butt causes the fight to be stopped, you go to the scorecards after the third round. You can be saved by the bell in the last round only, and only the referee can stop the fight. Jim?
Thank you, Harold Lederman. Right now, let's go up to ring announcer Michael Buffer for the pre-fight introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, Top Rank Incorporated, along with the undisputed, undefeated King of Beer, Budweiser, in association with the Reno Sparks Convention and Visitors Authority, present the featured bout of the evening. This bout is sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission. Chairman, Dr. Elias Ghanem. Commissioners, Nat Carasalli, Luther Mack, Dr. James Nave, and Bruce Lane. Chief Inspector at ringside, Mark Ratner. Physicians in attendance, Dr. Philip Omansky, Dr. James McLennan, and Dr. James Heflin. Timekeeper, Jim Carpenter. Counting for the knockdown seconds, John Rogers. The scoring for this bout will be done on a 10-point must system, and the three judges assigned at ringside are Patricia Jarman, Doug Tucker, and Keith McDonald. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, referee Joe Cortez. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from the biggest little city in the world, Reno, Nevada, let's get ready to rumble! 10 rounds of boxing in the heavyweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the blue trunks with white trim, weighing in at an even 216 pounds, from Johannesburg, South Africa, ranked number 12 in the world by the International Boxing Federation, he brings an excellent professional record of 39 victories, 27 KOs against 4 defeats. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing Pierre Costa. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the red trunks with white trim, weighing in at an even 258 pounds, ranked number 1 in the world by the International Boxing Federation, number 4 by the WBC, number 4 by the WBA. This 1968 Olympic gold medal champion is 71-3 as a professional, 66 by KO, introducing the former heavyweight champion of the world, Big George Foreman.
All right, gentlemen, we went over the rules in the dressing room. I want a good, clean fight. Obey my commands at all times. Shake hands. Good luck to both of you.
People don't want to see George Foreman hurt, but they do want to see him. And I think we can say the same for all of us.
I'll buy that. His popularity certainly remains intact, as evidenced by the outpouring of affection that greeted Buffer's announcement of his name. Referee is Joe Cortez. Foreman says we won't see as much of the crab-like Archie Moore defense tonight
as has been evident throughout the comeback career.
Well, he said we wouldn't see it at all. We've already seen it twice.
That's right. He started right off with it as Kutzer went to the jab.
And he said he was going back to basics. He was going to stand there and snap the jab. Never mind the Archie Moore defense.
And incidentally, the ring tonight, only 17 and a half feet along each side. That is a phone booth. And it is something that George wanted so that he could get at Kutzer. So far, it's been all Kutzer in round number one. Kutzer landing the left to the top of George's head and coming back with two more. And Foreman paws forward with a left jab. And Kutzer stays this busy all night, you wonder if George will ever get started. Now there's an angry welt on Kutzer's nose, right on the bridge of his nose to begin the bout. It was heavily laced with salve yesterday when we met with him, and we don't know exactly how badly abraded that nose is.
Well, one thing, it isn't in a dangerous spot. Even if it busts wide open, there's no reason why they should stop a fight because of that kind of a cut.
That's right. It's well below eye level, so it wouldn't affect his vision at all. Kutzer landing a right through George Foreman's guard. And you see Pierre moving on his feet to the right, staying away from George's right hand.
And every time George lands a punch, everybody in the audience goes, ooh.
He landed a left jab to the side of Kutzer's face.
And Kutzer is moving to his right, which is a good thing to do, to try to avoid that stiff left jab of George Foreman's. There he is, moving off to that right again.
And George, whacking left hand by George.
And Angelo Dundee told me that Kutzer has a habit of bending to his right. And he says that when he does that, he's going to have George come up with left uppercuts. He said he thinks that will be the most effective punch in the fight. And there George just tried to get set to throw it, but Kutzer was gone by the time his reflexes told
George
him to do
throwing
it.
Punches at the speed that Larry Merchant described against Holyfield as second-class mail.
Come on, but eventually they do deliver second-class mail.
An active first round for Pierre Kutzer. A couple of red welts on his face already. And that nose is already bleeding on the spot where he had the salve yesterday.
Listen to me now.
All right, here is Kutzer against Riddick Bowe, and you can see some of the hard, hard shots that this man can take.
And look at him punch back after he gets hit, Larry.
Yeah.
That's a tough guy.
Maybe better than Tex Cobb and George Chivallo. There's the end of the fight when he caught a low blow. A couple of low blows in that fight hit him down around Johannesburg, but Bo had done a very good job of beating him down.
It could be said that Johannesburg hurt, but it was Pretoria that ended the fight. In round number one, Kutzer threw 70 punches, only 41 for George. But Foreman landed almost as many. He got 20. Kutzer landed 28 of his.
But I thought George's punches were more powerful when he did land that stiff jab.
Kutzer just backed George up with a straight right hand, though.
There he is in his old-fashioned stance, Gil.
Goes to show you what we say about teaching an old dog new tricks earlier. There's that stiff jab, and there it is again. But you see Kutzer punching back.
Kutzer with a solid left to Foreman's body. And there's a welt under Foreman's left eye. Can't tell if that's his blood or Kutzer's blood.
Now that's his blood, Jim. He started to swell in the first round underneath that left eye.
Well, that's exactly what happened against Stewart. He swelled up so rapidly it was shocking.
That's what Kutzer does. He punches back. You can hit him or whatever, but you have to move after you throw your punches because he's going to be there to punch back.
It's amazing to watch Kutzer's capacity to keep his eyes open, looking straight ahead and concentrating on punching, even while taking hard punches from his opponent.
Come on.
And Kutzer now is cut under the left eye.
This could become a bleeding contest.
Well, again, it's going to depend on the referee and the doctor to see if these tournament can take care of the cuts. I know Angelo Dundee can take care of George's.
Kutzer's camp was very dissatisfied with Mills Lane after the bow fight. They don't know much about Joe Cortez, but they were happy that the referee would be him instead of Lane.
There's that stiff jab.
Yeah, George is starting to tattoo him with the jab. Right hand by Kutzer, backs Foreman up again. And there's a lot of blood streaming from the welt in the middle of Kutzer's nose. The right hand chases Foreman backward. A left right on Foreman's chops.
I think Kutzer is trying to discourage him from throwing those lefts with that right hand, Gil.
Well, he's got another thing he should try to do is move his head, Larry. He just never moves out of the way of a left jab.
Well, he's afraid he might not get hit.
He's mad if he gets missed.
Beautiful with the jab. That's all
Joe,
you need.
Joe, you want him to turn around?
Huh?
You want him to turn around?
No, it's all right.
All right, let's take a look at that jab in action. Right on the nose. That splash of red blood is a target for George Foreman and will remain so as long as this fight goes
on.
Well, guys, we saw George through the fights against Jimmy Ellis and Alex Stewart becoming increasingly dependent on the jab, and the pattern continues tonight. In the first two rounds, George has only thrown 9 power punches. Every other attempted punch was a jab.
And here Kutzer comes out very, very active with that left jab.
And the right hand again. Kutzer has certainly taken a lesson from the Stewart fight, Gil.
Yes, he has. But I think that he should punch a little bit more to the body. He's trying to reach up, and George is a big man with those big arms. Just blocks those head punches.
There's Kutzer to the left of the body, and George snaps his head back to the jab. And another. And another jab. And another. George beginning to take control of this round with that straight telephone pole jab.
Good right hand by Kutzer. Right on the button.
But he eats 2 more jabs. And now the entire center of Pierre Kutzer's face becoming a bloody mask.
You know, Mickey Dubb, the famous London promoter, he said he loves Pierre Kutzer because he just fights hard enough to lose. Gives you a good fight, but he just doesn't win.
Mickey is a realist, isn't he? Foreman tries a power punch and goes back to the jab. George said he had been working and training on a straight right hand. So far, we haven't seen it.
There goes Kutzer. He's looking to reach George's chin with that right hand. He should be throwing to the body. Bend up and down with his head.
He's straight up and down. He's an easy target.
Nick's stamina will become a factor, Gil. Both fighters are richly bathed in sweat at this point.
Well, the thing with George is he's so relaxed in that ring that, as people say, he can go 30 rounds. He just doesn't seem to get tired. Now, they're going to have to take a look at that nose. It's really angry right now.
And George has begun to go to the left hook. He's landed two of them. Now comes back with the jab. But still a sitting target for Pierre Kutzer's straight right hand.
Again, Kutzer that time started to go to the body, but changed his mind.
Boy, we've seen some big men land some big punches tonight, guys. Whoa.
I want to close it, Doctor.
Come. There you see what Kutcher looked like while he was fighting Riddick Bowe. Not unaccustomed to sniffing his own blood.
That is an angry cut along his nose.
Why is that dangerous?
It's not dangerous, except the people don't like to see the sight of blood. And if it gets bad, the referee may get a little nervous or his doctor and stop the fight. It's not in a dangerous spot at all.
And now, gentlemen, as round four begins, we are joined at ringside by the victor in the first fight of the evening, Tommy Morrison. Welcome, Tommy.
Thank you.
You've had a little while to reflect on what happened in the first fight. Do you feel a little bit relieved that you came back from difficult circumstances?
I was able to. I think that's all part of learning. Why this is the sort of sport that you never stop learning. And, having these type of fights and coming back in those situations certainly, puts you in a step all by yourself, a different level. And that's what we're looking to do, because there's obviously some more levels that we have to get to before we accomplish our goals.
So how long is the learning process between now and the ideal time for you to have a title shot?
Well, at this point, some very interesting things are going to happen. There's a very strong possibility that Foreman and I could face each other after this. The victor of that fight has promised a shot either to, Riddick Bowe or Lennox Lewis. So there's some very exciting things going to happen, but you got to take them one at a time.
So what do you think of what you've seen against George, or seen of George against Kutzer so far here?
Well, the one thing that always impresses me against George is that he's so very calm. And he's a much better fighter now in his second career than he was in the first. That's something that's been said by a lot of people. Coach is the type of guy that, I was fixing to say that Kirk moves a lot, but he didn't get caught, and that's something he can't afford to do against George Foreman.
Right now, he's a guy like a lot of others who has just tasted the canvas against George Foreman.
And remember that Foreman said he wouldn't take pity on him the way he did against Stewart. He feels he let Stewart into the fight after knocking him down twice.
That right hand to the body hurt Kutzer badly. And now Kutzer is so body conscious that he's not guarding his face. But he comes back with a right hand to Foreman's face.
Kutzer can't take those body shots of George at all.
No, and he's so wary of the body shots that he's dropping his guard now, Gil. Remember that the three knockdown rule is in effect.
Are these guys warriors or what?
Taking punishment. Kutzer is taking punishment and still trying to punch back. Right now, George is just overwhelming him. There's that stiff jab again.
Well, Pierre Kutzer has as much guts as any fighter in the division.
Foreman turned to the referee and said to stop the fight after he landed that right hand.
Well, he said he wasn't going to take pity the way he did on Stewart, and it doesn't look like he is.
But he also said that compassion is always a part of his character, and that he will not wait to ask the referee to stop the fight if he thinks it's time.
And if the fighter is punching back, he can't stop it here. With less than half a minute to go.
Kutzer is likely to make it out of the round if Joe Cortez decides not to stop it.
Look at the guts that this Kutzer has. Still trying.
Tommy Morrison, your thoughts again?
Well, at this point, Coach is trying to, I think he should be moving a little bit more. He definitely has displayed a courageous champ, but George is a guy that's very calm, is able to capitalize on those situations.
Nothing, Doc, take him out. How you doing here? You want to continue? I want to continue.
Okay.
You okay? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jim.
All right. We'll look forward to seeing you again.
All right, here's the knockdown. It was a right hand. He hasn't thrown many of them. No, there was a left hand in there first, and it was the left hand that did it on a delayed knockdown. Very often when a punch fighter is hit with a punch he hasn't quite seen, it's like a parachute opening up a little bit late. And
all right, second down.
Harold, how do you see the fight?
Larry, 38 to 37, two rounds each, but George Foreman ahead by 1 point based on a knockdown. I went with the busier guy in the first two rounds, the harder puncher in rounds 3 and 4.
I've got Foreman ahead 3-1.
Mike called the first round. He even gave Foreman the next 3 rounds.
Oh, go on ahead, go on ahead. Let's go.
And you called round 4 a 10-7 round.
Yes, I did. I thought that George gave him a terrible beating in that fourth round.
Well, George landed two-thirds of his punches in round 4. And unlike the first three rounds, when almost every punch was a jab, he went back to power shots in the fourth.
The jab sets everything up, though, Jim. Gets him on the end of that left jab, then he falls for any kind of feint that George wants to throw.
Well, the other thing we learned in the fourth round is that Kutzer takes it to the chin better than to the body. If George goes back to the body, he'll set up a knockout.
Kutzer cannot take a body shot. I've seen him be hurt in other fights anytime he gets hit in the body. Of course, Bo hit him low, but maybe if the punch was a little higher, it would have had the same effect.
That's true of a lot of guys with washboard stomachs, isn't it?
Well, he's got... He doesn't have to protect the belt around him the way George does.
That's right. George has a pad. Foreman's pace slowing again in round number 5, giving Kutzer a chance to become active again, but he's only taking marginal advantage of it. Kutzer badly off balance there, but George didn't deliver a shot.
George is breathing kind of deep right now, Jim. He really is showing little signs of fatigue.
Well, that jab is really something when you watch it snap Kutzer's head back. Place George's jab in historical context in the heavyweight division, Gil.
I think the only other guy that had a stronger jab as George Foreman was Sonny Liston.
Who was Foreman's idol early in his career.
Better than Joe Louis?
Yes. Joe Louis had a different kind of a jab. Joe Louis's jab had more snap, could bust you open more than a George Foreman jab or a Sonny Liston jab. Theirs is like a plank coming out of a window. Look at that combination by Big George.
And he went to the body again, and when he goes to the body, Kutzer stops punching and just stands and waits to take it. Now Kutzer goes to the body. And that's something I think he should do more of. Join us tomorrow night for an American reunion, the People's Inaugural Celebration, the first and biggest of the inaugural events to be attended by President-elect Clinton and Vice President-elect Gore, and featuring a multitude of performances by top entertainers. There are the names. Don't miss this HBO exclusive special, a one-time only, same-day telecast, Sunday, January 17, 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern and Pacific Time, an American reunion, the People's Inaugural Celebration.
Nice and easy, George.
We're running it.
The jab's everything.
Okay. We're running.
We'll give it a round.
Second down.
You heard George asking what round this is. Could mean he's getting a little tired. He fought a tired round.
He looked a little tired last round, but still, he's just, anytime he lands any of those big bombs, whether it be a jab or whatever it is, it's just so effective.
During the Alex Stewart fight, Foreman was also asking his corner men what round it was. In George's defense, guys, I often ask our stage manager, Don Lahan, what round it is.
There's that jab. Kutzer just doesn't seem to have any kind of effective power in his punches at all. He just doesn't move Big George.
Well, that was the case against Riddick Bowe as well. He landed a lot of solid blows against Bowe and didn't seem to knock him loopy at any time. Same thing is happening here.
I thought that the punches had a little more effect on Riddick Bowe than having on Big George.
Well, George is bigger.
He is bigger, there's no question about that. I wonder how much he weighs right now, though.
258 yesterday. I wouldn't rule out 265 or 270. He said he was going to have a big meal. Uppercut by Foreman. And Kutzer comes back with a left and a right.
All George has to do is throw a couple of body punches now. And this fight's over.
I think something else just opened up on Kutzer. Another.
Yeah, I think his right eye is open, Larry. I think you're right about that.
That's bothering him. Was that the same eye that Bo opened? I don't recall.
Bo opened both eyes. Oh, solid right hand by Foreman over the top. There's that straight right hand he told us he would have.
Well, he mentioned to be back to basics. We haven't seen the Archie Moore defense in quite a while.
Kutzer with a straight right, no effect on Foreman. George plows forward. Hasn't remembered to go back to the body where both you and I believe, Gil, that he could set up an easy knockout.
Is this looking like a guy who could star in a sitcom?
Well, there's nothing funny about George Foreman in the ring.
And it must be difficult for George, given his palpable mercy streak, to pound away at a guy who looks as grotesque as Kutzer appears at this time.
Well, the thing is with Kutzer, every once in a while he punches back. And George has to go on the offense to keep from getting hit.
Time! How's it going, buddy? You got that. Yeah, keep pitching.
Okay. Are you doing all right?
Let me work on you.
You're right.
Please,
you're right.
Okay. Listen. Yeah. Now you feel it.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Just don't let him catch you. Don't let him catch you on the eye.
Take a look at some of those jabs that is forcing Kutzer's people to do some quick surgery in the corner, just as Foreman is doing some surgery in that corner.
You know, if I was in Kutzer's corner right now, I would really think of stopping the fight. What could he possibly do to win this fight? He doesn't look like he has the power to hurt George, unless George collapsed from heat exhaustion or something. I don't think he has a chance to win the fight. He's just taking more and more punishment.
They did throw in the towel in the battle against Bruno in London.
Right now, he looks, as Hank Williams once sang, like he'd have to get better just to die.
That's about it.
Nice one.
His manager said that the reason they threw the towel in London is not that he was in bad shape, but he was getting fouled so often, and they weren't doing anything about it, but he just decided to stop it. He was going to show them.
Uh-huh.
But all the happy, all the head.
That's referee Joe Cortez telling Kutzer not to hold behind the head.
No, I think if I was refereeing, I'd let Kutzer do anything he could possibly do.
I started to say that. Why be cruel?
Is this fight becoming an anticlimax after the first one? Maybe it is.
Well, that happens often, Larry. It's tough when you got a guy in the main bout and the semifinals, a great fight.
Would another 10-round decision damage Foreman's appeal as a heavyweight contender? Is his identity dependent on knockouts?
You can just see the exhaustion of Pierre Kutzer. Missed the punch and almost fell on his face. And it's again, Jim, it's a question of how George Foreman looks. And he gets a knockout in this round or the next round. It's not going to change the public's opinion at all.
Tell me, Gil, what good fighter in his comeback has he knocked out?
Silence.
Jerry Cooney?
Jerry Cooney. I thought, you know, I trained Jerry Cooney. I thought I had him in great shape for that fight. Real good sparring partners. Everything looked like he was in excellent condition, but George just rolled all over him.
Are you answering in the affirmative about Jerry Cooney? Are you saying he was
good
fighter?
I thought that George Foreman beat a good fighter when he beat Jerry Cooney.
Kutzer with an uppercut. But George, it doesn't seem to bother George.
George is an incredibly powerful human being. I mean, I don't remember seeing him take many bad backward steps in the 7 years of his comeback. He just keeps coming no matter what. He's really amazing.
He's an incredibly powerful human being, both physically and psychically. An awesome presence in there.
George is now cut under the left eye.
Yeah, he's bleeding. But by no means is his face the grotesque mask that it became against Alex Stewart. He's taken a lot of punches tonight without getting broken up the way he did in that fight.
Well, Larry, you mentioned there's any good fighters that George Foreman has beaten.
No, I said knocked out.
Knocked out. Mm-hmm. Sorry about that. Got the question wrong.
No problem.
Where?
Right. On your eyelid, no problem.
What wrong is that?
I'll get it. This number 8 coming up. Come here, partner. Come here.
That was at the end of 10 rounds against Alex Stewart. George doesn't seem to be on the way to that tonight.
Okay.
All right, sure open up.
Got hit him with an elbow. Hit you with an elbow. It's okay.
Is Angelo Dundee a con artist or what?
He's great. Absolutely great.
Harold, how do you score the fight so far?
Larry, 68-64, five rounds to two, George Foreman. I tell you the truth, Larry, I seen totem poles that Bob and Weave better than Pierre Kutzer. He's just standing too straight up, and George is pounding him. George has swept the last five rounds of my scorecard, got a commanding four-point lead.
Yeah, I have him ahead 6-1.
In 7 rounds, George Foreman has thrown 199 jabs and landed 132 of them. That's a connect percentage of 66%.
And these are powerful jabs, Jim. They're not just flicks or fly swatter jabs. They're good, solid punches. George's jab is as good as some guy's right hand.
Yeah, when you talk about Foreman's dependence on the jab, it's a little bit like Tommy Morrison's dependence on the left hook. As Larry said, he was the opera singer who could only sing?
Gallicherchi. From what you see here, right now, if they go through with their contract, Foreman and Morrison, what happens, Gil?
Well, I think that George would be in with a younger, quicker, stronger guy that could really hurt him in the fight. If Morrison showed in the Williams fight that he can get hurt, but I think the speed of Morrison's punches would be a little too fast for George.
So you would make Tommy the favorite over George Foreman?
Yes, I would.
Which is probably why George will try to avoid that fight if he can.
Yeah, I got a feeling that it's not going to turn out to be in the best business interests of either guy. Either one is potentially a championship contender without making that fight. Down goes Kutzer, second time in the bout.
Beautiful 1-2 by George Foreman. Through two combinations in a row. Second one, a beautiful 1-2. And George is puffing over there in that corner.
Well, how much more of this does Pierre want?
The referee said, do you want to stop it? Kutzer shook his head, no.
And now Joe Cortez disagrees. So Foreman gets the stoppage, just as Morrison did in round number 8.
Gentlemen, we saw tonight why people love to watch heavyweight
boxing.
No question about it. There was a lot of solid punches landed.
Guys going up and down, guys bleeding.
Hey, think of the heavyweight fights we've had here in the last 2.5 months, huh? Lennox Lewis against Razor Ruddock, lightning knockout. Evander Holyfield against Riddick Bowe, a battle for the ages. And tonight, two bloody wars.
Let's take a look at this beautiful one, too, by George
Foreman. That might have been the most artistic combination George has thrown in a long time.
Larry, right before that 1-2, he threw a three-punch combination, which was also picture-perfect. Look at that. 1-2, button my shoe right on the chin.
And he's in a position now to button his shoe.
Yes, he is.
And you see Kutzer dripping blood on the mat.
There's the three-punch combination that I was talking about just before he landed the 1-2. And there's the 1-2.
So George Foreman goes to 27-1 and has come back 72-3 overall. And we go up to ring announcer Michael Buffer for the official particulars.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Joe Cortez has to stop the bout at 1:48 in round number 8. The winner by TKO, the former heavyweight champion of the world.
Take a look at final punch stat numbers and keep in mind that the overwhelming percentage of Foreman's landed punches were jabs, but as Gil Clancy points out, a jab like none other in the heavyweight division. Pierre Kutzer landed 174 blows and threw more than 100 punches more than Foreman. But it wasn't enough to bother Big George, who just kept methodically stepping forward and delivering his own tattoo. Now here's a look at the jabs. Foreman landed 147 out of 218, 67%. Kutzer threw more jabs, but not nearly as effective. George has wasted no time in donning the shades that make him look like a bulbous rock star. And right now, Larry Merchant is standing by with him. Larry?
Okay, George, I see that the sun has come out and you've got your sun.
Yeah, Rachel.
Uh-huh.
I'm cool. I want all the kids to know I'm out there. I'm cool. I got this shave head.
All right.
And I got a Corvette.
Georgia, have you ever won
Mama, how you doing? I love you. You know.
Georgia, have you ever won a fight before with so many jabs, almost exclusively the jab until the right hand just ended it?
Time after time, you're going to meet guys who are a lot tougher than you. Years ago, the Muhammad Ali days, I would have went wild trying to get that knockout shot, but I got a little older and wiser now, so I took my time and realized I got a good left jab. Why not use it? I'm winning.
And he was,
Just so tough. This is a tough guy. God bless him and his country.
You had him hurt in an early round, and I saw you turn to the referee. Did you ask the referee to stop the fight?
I really did, and then something's going to have to be done with you referees. At what expense do they take these guys' lives into their hands? And I mean, so they're going to have to do something. Why he didn't stop that fight and let the guy go on and get beat and knocked down again is strange. I mean, look, we're going to have to get some safety rules. Why? I'm a puncher. I'm not a boxer. I can, at any time, I can execute a guy with my fist. It just so happened that I'm in shape and I can't hold back. But these referees are going to have to do something. Something's going to have to be done.
In the next round, you had an easy round. You said you wouldn't show compassion this time because
no,
of what happened.
I'd always be a little merciful because the merciful always obtain mercy in their lives, too. I took it easy and see if he was going to get back on his feet, moved around a little bit, and then got his strength back, and I knocked him out in good power. So I'm happy about that. I didn't go wild on him and try to hurt him. I just tried to knock him out.
All right, let's look to the future. You have a contract to fight Tommy Morrison. What did you think of Morrison in his fight?
I felt like when I saw Tommy Morrison, I mean, it's the way when the people saw the first Frankenstein movie. That big monster jumped up, and you just don't want to fight him. Tommy Morrison is too dangerous for George Foreman. I want his brother, somebody who can't fight. I want Pee Wee Herman. Pee Wee Herman. We want Pee Wee.
Well, so you say you're not going to go through with that fight? You're going to look for a championship fight?
No, I'm not saying that because promoters, they're the one who dangle those green stamps in front of you. And my wife, I don't know. She said, look, I don't want to be nervous anymore. I got to go home and talk to her. If she say I can't come back in the ring, I may not even come back. It's up to my wife. But Tommy Morrison is a dangerous young man. He used to get knocked down. That was the end of him. Now he gets up and wait later on. I don't want no part of that monster.
Well, nobody believes a word of what you say about your wife, so let's go on.
Oh, no, it's true. Next question.
No,
it's true. My wife has warned me. She said, all right, now come on home. I'm nervous in the stomach. I'm tired of it, so I may have a little compassion. I didn't know she felt like me.
All right, there are now officially two heavyweight champions out there. Will you fight either one?
I would prefer the one in England, because he haven't turned me down yet. I mean, he did not make a verbal agreement with me and back out. So, what's his name? Lennox Lewis. I really would like him. Lennox Lewis. Forget Riddick Bowe. He's on some kind of trip. And he's not a baby boomer. He's like he's one of those kids that need a spanking.
And you want to give the spanking to Lennox Lewis, however.
Yeah, I would prefer Lennox Lewis. He's tall, and I think he's a bit more braver than the Riddick Bowe camp. Now, I'm not going to say Riddick Bowe is not brave, but his manager's kind of scared of this old guy. I'm 45 years old, and I got those young fellas scared of me. That's strange. So you old people, senior citizens out there, don't be scared of those gang members. The reason they group up and try to rob you, they scared of you because you're older than they are. We're going to get head wrapped. We're going to wrap them around our head. We're going to get earrings in our ear, and we're going to terrorize the street. We're going to have those gang members go in. You saw what happened. George Foreman is back.
All right, now George Foreman is gone and back to ringside.
All right, for the record says that he's 44, not 45. It's too late to be adding years to your age, George. And as for your wife, we know now she's a paper tiger. If what she said went, this fight wouldn't have taken place, because she's the one who said last year after the Stewart fight that he wouldn't be fighting again. He talked about Riddick Bowe. Let's go to Riddick once again now at Brookdale Caesars in the Poconos in Pennsylvania. Riddick, you heard what George says about you, that you deserve a spanking. Obviously, he's referring to the fact that the tentative plan for a fight between yourself and George did not come off. What happened, if anything, in the negotiation between your manager, Rock Newman, and George Foreman's people for a possible Bowe Foreman defense?
Well, George kind of thought like he was a champion, unfortunately, but whenever George wants to fight, or well, any heavyweight out there for that matter, I'm willing and able.
Did it not happen because George asked for half the money and equal billing with you?
And then some.
And then some. All right. Well, that's not terribly surprising, frankly. Riddick, you said that he had to win and win impressively to maintain his status as a contender. Did he fulfill that prerequisite?
Well, not really. He let Pierre carry him into, you know, the eighth or ninth round. I thought George should have had the ability to stop Pierre a bit sooner.
So, at this moment, is Tommy Morrison the more attractive contender than George Foreman?
I would have to think so, but I'm confident I can knock both of them out on the same night.
There has been some talk about a Morrison-Foreman fight. Do you expect that it would ever happen?
Well, I think they're compatible, so I think that fight would be very interesting.
All right, Riddick, we've kept you up late tonight to watch both of these fights. We appreciate that. I know you'll be back in training tomorrow, and we're looking forward to seeing you in Madison Square Garden on February 6th.
Okay.
All right, thanks very much. Gil Clancy, your final thoughts about George Foreman, who dominated the fight with that telephone pole jab. Did he look good enough?
Well, you know, he really is his own manager. He's the best manager in the world. He knew that Kutzer walks right into those left jabs. He knew he was the perfect opponent, and it worked out that way. I don't think George will ever look this good again.
All right, that's a statement in and of itself. You don't think he'll ever look this good again. How would he do against Bowe or Lewis?
Well, again, we have the younger guys, the more active guys. They're both big guys. I think that either one of them would probably, at least they'd beat George anyhow in tough fights.
Would they knock him out?
Well, George is one of these guys. He's got a great chin, and maybe in the latter rounds he may get tired and he may go, yeah.
Gil, thank you very, very much for another wonderful job standing in for George with us tonight. We always have a ball working with you.
Thank you. Well, I'm only the designated hitter. Come back, George.
Larry Merchant.
He's coming back.
That's right. George has created a whole new industry for Gil working here on HBO. Your final thoughts on two interesting and in some cases exciting heavyweight fights.
Well, as I noted after the last fight, this is heavyweight boxing. This is what thrills people who really aren't fight fans. They're heavyweight boxing fans. And it thrilled me because we're going to have a fabulous year in heavyweight boxing. If I had my druthers, I'd want to see Bowe fight Lennox Lewis tonight, tomorrow, as soon as possible. But that doesn't seem to be happening. They're both taking the corporate route, and perhaps next year they will have built that match up to something extra, extra special. But in the meantime, we're going to have a lot of heavyweight fights. Every heavyweight out there is now inspired, as Williams was tonight, to come out there and do his best because a good performance can get you some other shot. A win can catapult you into a seven-figure fighter. Every round, every punch carries a big dollar tag on it. And in addition to the sheer drama of seeing guys up and down and show their courage as we saw tonight, a lot riding on every heavyweight fight. And boy, I'm just as excited as I've ever been about an upcoming boxing year.
I'm thinking maybe if I put on 35 pounds, I can get a title shot. You want a title shot?
No,
well, no. All right. Maybe I'll think second thoughts about it, too. All right, let's take a look back now quickly at what happened in these two fights tonight. First of all, in the battle between Tommy Morrison and Carl the Truth Williams, Morrison floored Williams in the first and third rounds. Williams floored Morrison twice in the fifth round and seemed to have seized control of the fight. And with Williams ahead on two of the three scorecards, Tommy Morrison put him down and ultimately got the technical knockout in the eighth round again. The left hook was a sensational weapon. And then in the second of our two fights, Big George Foreman got his third consecutive victory in the wake of his title shot loss to Evander Holyfield. This time a TKO at 148 of the eighth in a bloody battle with Pierre Kutzer. And once again, as has been the case for George so many times in his unbelievable career, the left jab was the dominant blow. Look at what it did to Kutzer's nose. Coming up immediately following tonight's coverage of World Championship Boxing on the East Coast, stay tuned for CIA Codename Alexa. On the West Coast, we'll see Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country. Next month, we continue to celebrate 20 years of boxing on HBO. First, on February 6th, heavyweight champion Riddick Bowe makes his first title defense against Michael Doakes. And then 1 week later, IBF super middleweight champion Iran Barkley defends his title against IBF middleweight champ James Toney. Two world championship fights live on HBO. And we remind you, join us tomorrow night for an American reunion, the people's inaugural celebration. The first and biggest of the inaugural events to be attended by President-elect Clinton and Vice President-elect Gore, and featuring a multitude of performances by top entertainers. Don't miss this HBO exclusive special, a one-time only same-day telecast, Sunday, January 17 at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern and Pacific Time. So now for Larry Merchant, Gil Clancy, and Harold Lederman, I'm Jim Lampley saying so long from Reno, Nevada. The executive producer of HBO Sports is Ross Greenberg. Tonight's coverage of World Championship Boxing was produced by Rick Bernstein and directed by Mark Payton. The associate producers were Michael J. Whalen, Kendall Reed, and Jeff Kuiper. Feature producer, Brian Brown. Assistants to the producer, Adam Berger, Dave Leapson, and Artie Curry. The production manager was John McKelly. And the technical supervisor was Bob Hunter. Presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.
My first name is Riddick. My last name is Bo. I'm heavyweight champ, in case you didn't know. Many have compared me to the greatest Ali, but I hit like a truck. He just sounded like a beast.
See Riddick Bo's first title defense, Saturday, February 6th, only on HBO.
I tell you, Doakes, you shouldn't show up. Michael Doakes is so ugly, he hurts my feelings. Think you've seen boxing that's great? Riddick Bowe is on HBO. Just you wait. That rhymes. I like that.